Yes. It was, I still remember being in the first class. So, ladies and gentlemen, if I could have your attention for just a moment. My name is Rob Whitworth.
I serve as the principal at Bishop Lewis Riker Catholic School. It is my privilege to do so. And then because of that today, I get to just say an initial welcome to you. And then we're going to do a presentation. I want to say welcome. I want to say a prayer. And I'm going to introduce the president of our school, Mr. Evans. And so if you would join me for just a moment in a prayer in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God, our Father, we thank you for this day, for the gift of our lives, and for this opportunity to come together, particularly around our parish Catholic school. We thank you first, Lord, for the folks, for our benefactors who had the vision to found this school here, through whose generosity we have these beautiful facilities and these opportunities that we have before us. We recognize that that they have been a great blessing to us, and we commend them to you for their generosity to us. We also thank you for the current school community, for the parents and the students who have made the sacrifices to come here and to entrust their most precious gift, their children, to us, and to recognize what a bond of trust that is. For our prospective parents who are discerning, we welcome them. We hope that they get a tiny sense of what the Bishop Lewis Riker community is about so that they can discern what is best for their children. And we recognize as we enter into this season of Lent that we are disciplining ourselves. We are fasting, we are praying, we're giving alms in a way to open ourselves more completely to God's presence. And so we know that in the gift of Christ, we have our Savior. We are preparing ourselves to walk his passion, death, and resurrection at Easter, and to be open to what all of that means. And so as we do, we pray, soul of Christ, sanctify us. Body of Christ, save us. Blood of Christ, inebriate us. Water from the side of Christ, wash us. Passion of Christ, strengthen us. O good Jesus, hear us. Within your wounds, hide us. Suffer us not to be separated from you. From the malignant enemy, defend us. In the hour of our death, call us, that with your saints we may praise you forever and ever. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And now I'd like to introduce Mr. Evans, who is the president of Bishop Lewis Riker Catholic School.
Thank you, Mr. Whitworth, and thank you all for joining us today. For our current parents, we hope you find today's information useful, and for our prospective families, we hope that you leave today having found a new home. For over 60 years, Bishop Riker Catholic School has been educating and shaping young hearts and minds. We've been continuously committed to cultivating leaders, inspiring scholars, and fostering saints throughout those decades. The beautiful attributes of joy, unity, relationship, and excellence are the core values we strive to live at Bishop Riker. We're incredibly proud of our rich and spirited history, a culture that has developed young men and women who have achieved and excelled in their ambitions. Among the many careers and vocations in which our graduates excel, we continue to focus on making sure that our students practice their faith, become productive members of society, and serve their families and communities long after they leave this place. The tradition, the essence, and the spirit of Bishop Ryker must never be left behind. The family that we are, the Christian charity we express towards each other, and the fierceness of competition must always be kept alive here. As people of faith and hope, we can all agree that the possibilities at Bishop Ryker may well be limitless. If, as Jesus says, where your heart is, there your treasure will be, the heart of Bishop Ryker can most definitely be found in the people here, in its faculty, its students, its parents, and its benefactors and supporters. For them come love and compassion, care and unity. These are the qualities of a successful school that we strive to live every day here. We must all work together to accomplish these goals. And in order to be successful, Bishop Ryker must be a fully functioning school, from quality care for our youngest students to challenging coursework for our upper grades. A school filled with joy is a true mark of good things happening. Gone are the days of doing things because we always did them that way, or not doing things because we never did them that way. It must become much more than that. After all, saints are in it for the ultimate long haul. That's eternity. Parents do not want to enroll their one-of-a-kind, irreplaceable, most precious commodity in an irreplaceable school, and we understand that here. We need to look at our tuition, our development efforts, our fundraisings in ways that will make the school more affordable to every Catholic family who wants an education. We need to be able to improve our offerings that we already have and to offer more as our teachers are provided with the best enrichment and training to be able to give that to our students. We're currently looking for ways to enhance our fine arts programs and to ensure that we have outstanding extracurricular offerings for our students. We know that the road to success is paved by continuing to build a premier faith-based educational system. And we're going to find ways to make it more affordable, more effective, and more filled with the joy of the Lord. This past year, Bishop Ryker was fortunate to receive over $1.5 million in development funds, receiving generous grants from local and national foundations, private donations, diocesan grants were all part of this process. During the last year, we were able to profoundly enhance the academics, the technology, beautification, facilities, and our ability to provide over $800,000 in tuition assistance to the families of Bishop Ryker Catholic School because of those gifts. Through these gifts, we were able to complete multiple programs and renovations this year. Just a few of those were the implementation of our humanities curriculum and many other opportunities for our students and staff through our unique partnership with the University of Dallas, which you'll hear a little bit more about when Mr. Whitworth gets up here. The renovation of our school's athletic weight room to provide our students with a first-class health and wellness experience. We purchased a new bus to make sure that our students are safe traveling on and off campus. We've provided additional financial support for our campus ministry program. We've added a full-time learning specialist to serve the needs of our students at our lower and high school campus that need those extra services. Rebranding of our school, including new building signage, fence wraps, professionally designed branding guides, which house all of our new logos and branding marks. These wonderful enhancements, coupled with the recent beautification of our landscaping, classrooms, teachers' lounge, hallways, they all bring new life to a school that is rich in history and spirit. I'm incredibly proud of what we have accomplished with the help of our benefactors, our alumni, our staff, our students, and our parents. Together, we will make Bishop Lewis Ryker Catholic School the most outstanding Catholic school in the country, and I truly believe that. But at Bishop Ryker, our focus doesn't have to stop there. It's paramount that we teach our students by word and example about the love of God and their responsibility to share that love with those around them. After all, it's the most important thing we do here. In the cultivation of the faith lives of our students, Bishop Ryker proudly stands in stark contrast to our competitors. Through our service, faith, and community, we spread the gospel, and that commitment must always be what guides us. Together, as one unified Catholic school community, that is the only way we'll experience true success for our most important assets, our students. So come and be set apart here at Bishop Ryker. We'd love to have you if you're a prospective family looking for a new home. And to our current families, know that we will always do everything within our power to make sure that your experience here is top-notch. If I can ever do anything for you at any time, please don't ever hesitate to reach out to me if there's something that I can help with to make your experience better. At this time, I'd like to turn it back over to Mr. Whitworth, so he's going to talk a little bit more about the academics and the transition we've been going through and touch a little bit on our partnership with the University of Dallas.
Thank you, Mr. Evans, and thank you all again for being here today. I want to talk a little bit about the academic side of the school in particular today. That's where some of the most significant transitions are occurring, and I want you to be aware of, first of all, what that vision is. I'd like to share with you a little bit of what we've done to date, what our challenges are, and then how we would like to move forward within that realm. So, once again, thank you for being here. So, first of all, it's important to understand that we are a parochial school. That means that Bishop Lewis Ryker Catholic School is a ministry of St. Louis Catholic Church, and as such, we very much value our being a part of the parish life and part of the parish community, and recognize that we have significant spiritual and financial support from the parish, and we are grateful for that, and that we in turn, as a school, want to contribute to the life of the parish. So as a part of Bishop Lewis Ryker Parish, Mr. Evans referenced our promise statement and our core values, and that's very much at the heart of what we're trying to do, is to remain focused on those things. So what is our promise statement? Our promise statement is come to Bishop Lewis Ryker and be set apart. Let's do something unique. Being here means we're called to something specific, and that calling is important. And I think God is calling families here for a certain type of education that they are wanting for their children, that they are wanting to be formed, and that in many ways it is unique, and it will set you and your family and your child apart. The purpose of that is that we are welcoming sinners and fostering saints. We are a community. We recognize that community is composed of imperfect human beings, but that we are called to something greater. It is the church's universal call to holiness, right? That everybody is called to that, and that we are to support one another in that calling. And so we join in the parish's role in doing that. We are an extension or a ministry of the parish in that regard. Let's see. And then we've talked about our core values: unity, relationship, joy, and excellence. These are the values by which we try to make decisions. We have conversations around how we are living these values out and ways in which we can do that. And so here in just a minute, we'll talk a little bit more about what each of those means. So the unity, I'm going to have to step over here for a minute because we believe that trust sets us free. We believe in candor and critical conversations. We believe that sharing our gifts and our struggles leads to health and holiness. And we believe that gossip and negativity wounds hearts and kills mission. So when we talk about unity, these are the points, these are the premises that we talk about. This is what we are seeking to live out when we seek to live out that value of unity. In relationship, we are children of God, not what we do or the sum of our worst failures. We pray before we act. We put people before paper. We place communication before decisions or actions. And we invite others to belong before we ask them to behave or believe, and that's part of being a community, entering into a community. joy. We believe that knowing Christ is contagious and the source of our joy. We believe that joy is a choice. We believe that joy doesn't depend on but changes our circumstances, the way in which we bring it to those circumstances. And we believe that sacrificial love brings joy. Excellence. We believe heaven above all else. Heaven is our goal. Everyone reaching heaven is our goal. We believe the good of others and the mission. We put the good of others and the mission above ourselves. And then we strive for truly excellent, and we dare to have lofty goals. And I think when we talk about the education, particularly on the academic side, this notion of excellence and of joy that we're talking about really comes across. And those are things that I think are important. So we have entered into a transition in which we are seeking to be a Catholic classical or integrated humanities school. People often ask, what does that mean? I'm going to talk about it in broad terms, in the overall vision, and I'm going to try to get a little bit more practical as well. But we believe that goodness, truth, and beauty exist, and they can be known, and that as such, that those are the proper goals of an education, is that we are to seek the truth, we are to do the good, and we are to love the beautiful, and that in doing that, we become fully human. But part of what the education is meant to do, our education is meant to do, is to awaken students to those realities, to those transcendentals within their lives, and for them to be able to understand what that means for them. So what this education is not, it's not a utilitarian education. Its ends are not practical. We believe that this serves the human purpose. It's rooted in our understanding of the human person, that we are a body and soul composite, and that what we seek to inculcate in our students is a sense of virtue, that they pursue that excellence that we talked about, that human excellence, in all areas of their lives. So the explicit goal is not college and career readiness, but being a fully human person. We believe college and career readiness comes as a result of these virtues, and it's not the end of the education itself. What is the proper end? What type of education, how do you go about inculcating virtues in our students? Here we focus on two virtues in particular in classical education: humility and magnanimity. What's meant by humility is not really not thinking less of yourself; it's thinking less about yourself. It's an ability to engage with the truth, beauty, and goodness outside you, and to begin to make sense of that. And then magnanimity is an openness to magnanimity literally means great souledness, that there's a certain nobility, that there's a certain openness to living the good life, to embracing moral principles and making that a part of your life. And so when we talk about humility and magnanimity, that's what we're talking about. So this is that definition of magnanimity from Webster's edition: a loftiness of spirit enabling one to bear troubles calmly, and to display a noble greatness. So there's a calmness, a nobility about the person, and that's what we want to. That's the kind of virtue, the kind of habit we want to build in our students. What we're trying to do here in growing these virtues of humility and magnanimity is we believe we are tilling the soil. We know that that what we can do by exposing our students to these notions of goodness, truth, and beauty, to presenting them with the gospel, the good news, that we can't control those outcomes of them. But what we can do is till the soil of their soul so that they are open to God's grace. And that is what this education seeks to do. To till the soil of their soul so they become open to the way in which God's grace is working in their lives. So how do we go about this? We try to create experiences for your students that allow them to delight in the things around them, to delight in the object of their lesson, whether that be in science or in math or in literature or in history or theology, that once we've created these educational experiences for them, that creates a certain delight in them. And we want for that delight to move their soul to a sense of wonder. And once you've created a sense of wonder in a child, an openness, a certain awe about what's happening in their lives, what God is doing in their lives, then they begin to take ownership of their education, right? And very much part of what we're trying to do through this classical education is by exposing them to these various experiences and opening them to that, they begin to take responsibility for their education in ways that we will show through the methods that we employ. And so we want them to revel in that sense of wonder. So, you know, how do we intend to inculcate virtue and promote the sense of wonder? Excuse me for just a second. So we employ the pedagogy that's complementary to our human existence. It's about it happens through the senses and through our experience. A recognition of the human person as a composite being, both body and soul. Recognizing that that body and soul is that we can't abstract our education. It has to be concrete, and that's part of what we're doing in the classroom in the way in which we teach. So we want to teach another word for classical education is liberal arts. It's meant to set people free, and what we mean by setting a student free is They receive so much information. We live in this technology age, right? And there's all of this information coming at them. How do they discern what information is good or bad, how they should use it, how they should utilize that? If education were simply giving them information, then we could accomplish that through a computer, we could accomplish that through just what is said to them. But we're trying to give them the ability to discern what is true, good, and beautiful, and how to incorporate that into their lives. And so we want them to do that. And so we're wanting a sense of true human freedom. And so that's part of what these virtues will allow them to accomplish. This is done through a study of what in the classical liberal arts is called the trivium. There are basically seven liberal arts at which we try to expose the students. There's the threefold study of language, which is grammar, dialectic, and rhetoric, and that's called the trivium. That's where students will spend a lot of their time, particularly at K-8, but we'll explain what that means. Grammar is the ability to name things and to read and to interpret. It's more than simply grammar and syntax. It's a way of filling their souls with good things to nurture them and to nourish them. What does this mean? It means that we work to make the classrooms alive with music, with poetry, with stories, and that we are working to make sure that we are feeding their imaginations and their soul. It's very much a poetic education, one that opens it to opens their imagination to the possibilities and is meant to insinuate in them particular loves. What is good, what is true, what is noble, and they do that. The best way to convey that to kids is not to tell them that this is good or true or noble, but is to fill them with stories that allow them to see that in action. And so that's part of what the grammar stage is, along with the learning of language. And we do that through, we have particular programs that we're working on, making sure that the students are able to master the skills that they need to access these stories. Dialectic simply means is logic. It's once they have these stories, once they have this background of information, We want them to be able to think. We want them to understand what the truth is and to be able to grapple with that. The way in which this happens, this logic stage or this logic integration of language is through dialogue in the classroom. Students understanding, developing a sense of empathy, developing a sense of in which they realize that they come to truth because they live in a community with other people, and in the discussion, in the logic, in the back and forth of the dialogue is where they arrive at that truth and they come to a sense of it. And so, you know, they view courtesy and empathy are again habits that we want to develop in the students as they have a discussion around what are the most important issues around human existence. We don't shy away from those issues. We actually embrace them, and in doing so, make our students stronger, make them think through what they believe about these issues, and also help them to be able to express them in a way that benefits their classmates. And then finally, rhetoric. Rhetoric is a final stage of trivium, the arts of language. This is where we want them to, once they have come to an understanding of the truth and they're at a stage, we want them to be able to express that. We want them to be able to express it well. They've studied something and they've found the truth about it, and we want them to be able to express that to others, whether that's in their speech or in their writing or whatever the case may be. We want them to be able to express that, and that's the art of rhetoric, and so we want them to master that. There's also the quadrivium, and basically the premise here is that just like language is a way of expressing truth, and that's the purpose of it, is to communicate the truth to the students, that another language is mathematics, and that this is where we take seriously the study of mathematics and the study of science, because these are ways of helping the students express what they come to see, particularly in the created universe. So arithmetic, geometry, music, and astronomy are the arts of the quadrivium, and we work to integrate those into our curriculum. Arithmetic is number, right? It's about being able to express realities to people. Arithmetic is the language of science, of art, of math, and so as we recognize this, we recognize that there's a special way in which an understanding and a mastery of this allows students to express themselves and to understand the world around them, and that we want them to have that sense of their place in the world and how numbers help them to understand that. Geometry is number in space. How do, once we've understand quantity and we understand what it's trying to relay to us about unity, about diversity, about multiplicity, about what happens in the world, then we look at how do we express this? What does this mean over space? And so the study of geometry coincides with that logic phase. And so we're very much trying to teach them through proofs and through understanding how to reason well. We want them to be able to reason well. They have these ideas within themselves, and we're exposing them to these great ideas. How do they reason well? And one of the tools by which they learn to reason well is geometry. Music is number over time. If you think about this, right, beats and rhythms and counts are, music is composed of this, and we try to create harmony by bringing these elements together. And so helping students to understand this. I love the quote from the philosopher Leibniz that says, music is actually the joy of the human mind counting without realizing that they're doing it. That these fine arts build certain ways of thinking even when we don't realize them. All of the things that we're talking about in terms of the importance of these various elements, if we go back and we confirm it, these are confirmed by scientific studies now that indicate that the key role that these play in kids' development. There's a lot of educational research out there that confirms that music builds mathematic ability in kids. Well, we want them to understand also how that's a, how those two interact and intertwine. And then astronomy is number over space and time. And here what we're simply wanting to do is have the students look up. Look up and see the world and see the sky and understand their place in it. Have a certain sense of awe around that. And that recognizing that the principles of astronomy, the sense in which there's a harmony in the universe, extends not just to astronomy but to all elements of science, whether we're talking on a planetary level or on a subatomic level. And so this principle of harmony extends throughout the universe, and that we can see that when we look for it and when we understand our way of looking at it. What have we done to begin to transition to a Catholic classical education? First of all, we've partnered with the University of Dallas. The University of Dallas has written a scope and a sequence to allow us to begin to make the important instructional shifts. The University of Dallas has approached a classical education as rooted in a philosophy and a pedagogy developed by a late 19th century Charlotte Mason. What we have right now is a K-8 scope and sequence for the humanities that we are working to implement at Bishop Lewis Riker. In particular, we have the the 6th through 8th, has a program that is written out and very well scripted, and that is a part of what we are piloting that program for the University of Dallas. But beyond that, we are working to implement the various parts of the scope and sequence, particularly at kindergarten through 8th grade. That's where that is the most well developed. What elements of Charlotte Mason? What is the pedagogy? How is it different? We're using things like oral reading and narration. In other words, kids are read a story in class if they can't read on their own, and then they are asked to narrate back that, and they're asked to emphasize different elements of the story. But what we're trying to get them to do is get a sense of this is how we're developing comprehension, this is how we're working on this. This oral narration is an ability for them to give the story back to us. We still use direct instruction and lecture. We utilize notebooks, note-taking and notebooks in particular, in science classes. A significant part of what we're asked to do in science at the lower grades is to take nature walks, to go out and look at something that the teacher has selected for the students to look at, either a particular area or maybe a particular tree, to observe and to draw. We're working to develop their powers of attentiveness and of observation so that they can describe to us what they are seeing. In addition to the content taught, we want to develop those abilities of observation. Copy work and dictation. It's true whether it's at K-8 or at the high school. We are seeking to put before them great works. They copy these. They will have them dictated to them so that they are creating their own textbooks through the notebooking and through the way in which they go about recording these. And then finally, recitation and memory work. The 6th through 8th graders in particular have been doing a lot of recitation and memory work. My daughter, who's a 7th grader, came home and had committed an entire psalm to memory. What they're doing is they're putting the psalm up, they're reading it as a class chorally, and then they come back and they work individually on it 2, 3, or 4 lines at a time in class. Probably many of you, if you are parents, current parents, haven't noticed that they had homework around this, your child was maybe struggling with the memory work. Most of the work for this is done in class, and so because of the rigor of what's happening, it is best done in class rather than sent home as homework. So what are the new programs that we have implemented so far as a way of doing this? One of them is Spell to Write and Read. This is our phonics and spelling program at at kindergarten through fifth grade. And so it introduces the phonograms, it introduces the rules of orthography, and basically it's a different approach to teaching reading. Most of you, when you were taught to read, if you were my age or even a little bit younger, you were taught to decode the text. You were given a text and you were asked to break the words down and to be able to read them. This is taking the opposite approach. It is teaching them to encode the language, teaching them the rules of phonics, what sounds these phonograms make, and then how do we write these, and it teaches them to encode so that they can then be able to read from there. But they begin by creating as opposed to reading independently themselves. And so those are important, that they develop a mastery of those. We have introduced Latin at grades 5 through 8. We have hired Latin teachers, two Latin teachers, one for 5th through 7th grade and 1 through 8th grade. The 8th grade Latin students are receiving high school credit for the Latin. The students in grades 5 through 7 are receiving 3 days of Latin instruction. We worked on implementing Latin at kindergarten through 4th grade, but we found that we're going to need more support from UD to be able to accomplish that because a lot of our teachers don't have a Latin background. So while we have worked to begun that program is an area where we're going to have to get additional support. So what are the new courses that we've introduced? I talked about the middle school humanities at grades 6 through 8. At high school, we've introduced a humane letters. Your students no longer take a separate English and a separate history course. They take a humane letters course, which they are reading works, and they are integrating, the history is integrated into the reading of the works. And so we are, so you're not going to have a separate government and economics course and English course as a senior. It's going to be the humane letters course where the content is integrated. We have introduced a reading, writing, and logic course at the freshman level in particular for freshmen, and they are working through a number of books. One is the writer's workshop, how to imitate your way to great writing. And so they are, through the art of imitation, they are understanding what the great writers are doing in their style and in their presentation, and they are working to imitate that so that they can repeat that and then again integrate it and make it their own. They are reading a book called How to Read a Book by Mortimer Adler, because as they delve into significant texts, they have to have the ability to be able to read and to understand these beautiful and profound works. And so part of that is training them how to do that. And so this reading, writing, and logic course does that. And then there's a section of it that deals explicitly with logic. This is a fallacy. This is a syllogism. These are the different types of fallacies. These are the different types of arguments that can be made. And so they're exposed to that so that hopefully it builds an ability to again, express themselves. What are the challenges we face this year? While I'm proud of what we've been able to implement, it is without a doubt we have also significant challenges. First is COVID and distance learning and instructional time that's hurt by quarantine, instructional time that's hurt by simply being away from school. And so so that's one of the areas in which we've struggled this year. I am very proud of the job that our faculty has done in being able to distance learn and teach in the classroom, and that's happened from grades 6 through 12. Our faculty deserve a great commendation for the work they've done, because it's been difficult, but I am grateful that we've been able to have kids, families in person who wanted to be in person, and those who needed to be distance learning are distance learning, but it does present challenges for us. We are working through the different, letting go of some of our previous ways of teaching. We have great teachers at Bishop Lewis Riker who understand very much, they've been doing this a long time, they've been successful at it, and as we've asked them to change some of their approaches and techniques, that's been difficult. And it's something that we continue to work with back and forth, what to hold on to and what to let go of as we embrace these new changes. And so I think, you know, the teachers come to me and they say, I'm not quite sure where the kids are because we haven't done it this way before, or we haven't covered this. In the past, we would have been doing this, and now we're doing this approach. And so in good conscience, they come and we work through those issues. So those are things that we continue to work through. Teachers are working diligently to master the Charlotte Mason pedagogy. It's different than what they were trained to do. And I think they have embraced it, and they have worked to do it to the best of their ability. But there are times when we have to step back and say, we don't think this is working. And we call the University of Dallas and we say, are we doing this correctly? Is there something we need to make an adjustment on? And so they do that. And the University of Dallas has been very responsive in helping us with that. One of our challenges as we move into these humanities courses is that oftentimes our teachers, right, they've either been teaching English or history, not both. So making connections in those courses is something that we struggle with. How do we do that? What is the connection between this and between what the university is having us teach here, and how do we make connections? So working to make those connections, we're continuing to do that. And as we grow in our understanding of what we want to accomplish, we will flourish. But that's an area that has been a challenge for us. I think communicating these changes to parents in a COVID environment has been difficult and not done well. And I have to offer you my apology for that. I would rather have time in front of you like this, where we have an opportunity to talk and talk about what these changes mean. And finally, as we are making changes to the instruction, how do we assess this? How do we relay it? Let me give you an example. The Spell to Write and Read program, they introduce the students to the phonograms, they give them spelling lists, and then the students begin to have spelling tests periodically throughout the semester. Well, one of the things with this program is it cycles back through these words so often that we're not as worried about mastery the first time. We're more worried about making sure that they have the phonograms and the basics than necessarily what their grade is. So there's a de-emphasis on numerical grade while we're still pushing the students to do their very best and to be excellent. And so sometimes the grading system we have set up is not set up well to convey to you what's being accomplished in class. And so we're going to have to work to make sure that you understand what's happening in the class and how we are gauging academic progress, since we're going about it differently. What do we have to look forward to? Continuing support from the University of Dallas in teacher professional development to help us master the pedagogy. The implementation of a math program, particularly at K to 8, we're looking at Right Start Math as a way of doing that. Finding ways in which we create the experiences that, remember early on where I talked about creating delight in the experience so that it creates awe and a sense of wonder? Well, that's done through hands-on. And so finding way in which science modules at the middle school and high school that we can make sure that we have adequate ways of making sure that the teachers have what they need to be able to create those experiences. And then the utilization of resources on both campuses. As the merger has taken place, we are very blessed, again, in our faculty and our staff, and we'll find ways in which those resources can be used more effectively. And then the development of a family and a house system whereby students understand that they are enrolled in a K-12 school, and that the benefits of that. I don't know if you've ever had the benefit of talking to some of our students, particularly, for instance, our eighth grade students who are mass buddies with their younger students. Oftentimes when we talk to them as they're leaving school, students most value that experience of being responsible for the younger kid and what they have learned from the younger student and that responsibility. So to build on something like that through a house system where the houses are, kids are divided up into houses where students would be at different grade levels and be interacting together. So forming house and family life around that are ways in which we could enrich this education. That is my presentation, and I wanted to open the floor, if I could, for a few minutes.
To any questions you might have. You guys have any questions? Yes, ma'am.
How long from last year when y'all started the integration to when you think it's going to be completely implemented?
I'm going to say that it's probably about a 3 to 5 year process to have it integrated. And even when we have made the transitions we want to, I think you will continue to see tweaking of the program, just like you would with any school, right? We're probably going to figure out, hey, this work that we're reading works well at this grade level, or it doesn't work well at this grade level, or this way of teaching the kids benefit. So, I mean, that part of it will be an ongoing process, but where I would be comfortable saying we've made the transition, you're probably looking at a 3 to 5 year time frame.
Any other questions? And if I went too far with
the theory of the liberal arts education, I apologize. It's something that I'm passionate about. It's something that I'm grateful to be here, to be able to help with this transition. I think it will make a profound effect. It will have a profound effect on your children and on your family life. One of the things that we've realized about Catholic school, one of the real benefits to Catholic school is that when we engage kids and they have these opportunities to learn either from the great works or from scripture or from the teachings of the church, is that when they come home and you ask them what they've done at school today and when they're excited to talk about what they've learned, it enriches family life. And that is our hope and our prayer, that not only does this education do something very profound for your child by opening them to that sense of delight and wonder, but it also is a way of that it comes back and pays dividends within family life.
Yes, ma'am.
What does the training look like for the student or the teachers who are transitioning into this?
So we had 3 full days of training at the beginning of the school year, and a lot of it has to do with modeling this pedagogy. One of the activities that they encourage us to do is an art study, a picture study. And so we went through with the teachers, what does this look like? What types of questions are you trying to ask of the student so that you open the student to the possibility? You're not trying to ask questions that are overly analytical. First, you want to open them to a sense of wonder, and then you can bring it down more specific. Same thing with what are good discussion stems in a Socratic discussion. If you're having kids discuss these works, then how do you draw them in? Because one of the principles of classical education is ultimately the teacher is not the center of attention. What happens when they're reading these great works is that the teacher poses questions and steps back, and the students, again, through their engagement with the text and their engagement with one another, become responsible in many ways for the learning that's taking place in the class. And that's a different approach, and it's a little unnerving because you're leaving class open to the ways in which the discussion leads them, and that's a different approach for all of us.
So they had
3 days. They probably had another 3 half days of training. The 3 days before school were in person. The other trainings have been virtual, and training for classical education virtually is a lot like trying to do it virtually. It's just difficult.
Yes.
So to go along with that training, do they have resources? The teachers have resources available to them online that they can reach out to?
So the University of Dallas, within their training, one of the things they do is they have things posted online. To me, the most helpful one is a book called Dancing Through the Trivium, where they go through and they describe this is what oral reading and narration looks like. Here's how to do it at different grade levels. And here are prompts and questions to do that. Here's a step-by-step way of doing dictation. And so they have resources that are available to them. And so I think that's been a blessing for us to be able to do that, yes.
Yes, ma'am.
And I would just like to add, some of those prompts really help the teachers in a general way. And so earlier this year, my class was talking about gravity. And as you said before, the class was discussing it. And instead of focusing on me, it became a conversation of why do I believe that gravity is this? And why do I think that your perception of what your definition is incorrect? And so it became not just a, I'm going to grade you on that right or wrong answer. It was kind of fleshing out the root of why they thought this way and then expanding it. And those prompts that we were reading off the website and through our 3 days really helped me introduce that to the class. I would not be able to form those questions without the guidance. So.
Thank you, Mrs. Clapp. And Mrs. Clapp teaches high school chemistry and physics. And so that they are having conversations around those issues is precisely what we want them to do. That's where I think the learning, a way in which the learning will be very meaningful to them in that way. And so we want to open them up to those, that conversation and dialogue. Of course, the teacher is there as the guide and to get things back on track and things like that. But their learning, I believe, more profoundly impacts them when they are directly engaged in it. Yes.
And real quickly too, I'm sorry, just to bounce off of what she said, in German class, we've been very blessed because Dr. Laura Eich from the University of Dallas has shared everything with us, and so I'm very grateful to her. But for example, she sent a picture study for us to project on the board and just kind of say, what do you remember? So we put the picture up and took it away. And the children would say, my students would say, I remember. And so like 3 kids would say, I remember. And it was a picture of like a fire with some pots cooking. And one kid would say, I remember, in German, they would say, I remember a pot. I remember a fire. I remember a small pot. But the cool thing was, in German, boom, 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 that kid learned from that kid, that kid learned from that kid, that kid learned. So it was kind of cool. And then the repetition of ich erinnere mich an, I remember, was the repetition helped them too. So they saw the beautiful art that she sent, the picture study, and then they learned from each other for all the vocab of I remember this object, this object, this object. And it was wild because I had never learned to teach like this before, but it was also very cool because it was a new way of teaching and I realized that the kids were learning so much more. And so I just wanted to share that.
Thank you.
And I've worked within my theology class, I've worked to implement it, and it was interesting. The kids were, I had them memorize a passage from Exodus on the Ten Commandments, and it was funny. One of the kids, when I put the passage up initially, he put his head down on his desk and said, I can't do that. And then we went through the methodology that UD taught us, and I said, you're not going to have this for homework. We're just going to work on it for 3 weeks, and then I'm going to ask you to recite it back to me. And so there were a couple of responses. One was the kid who put his head down on the desk, by the end of class, had 4 lines of this committed to memory and was very proud of himself. And the other kids who were in the class were like, ah, this is easy. I'm like, really? Why is that? And they're like, because we're doing it in German already. And so they'd already begun to work on this memory work. And so it was cool to hear them say, oh, well, we're using these pedagogical techniques across the curriculum and in different classes. And so for me, that was rewarding to hear that from them.
So
I'd like to again thank you for coming out to this afternoon. When you leave, you will have the opportunity to go on a tour of the school. I encourage you to do that when you step outside, and I will be happy to stay down here and answer any questions that I can. Again, thank you for your interest in Bishop Lewis Riker Catholic School. We are grateful for you being here.